And so in April this year, India had marked the 100th anniversary of the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Over the years, the UK government has never apologized for the massacre. But today, an apology by the senior most bishop of Church of England has put their government to shame. If you wonder what stops Britain from saying sorry, a word they taught the world, then here is the answer. An apology for Jallianwala Bagh massacre would renew calls for further apologies. When the UK was a colonial superpower, they had systematically conducted such atrocities across the world, from Asia to Africa to even Australia. So what has been London's position on the massacre? During her visit to India in 1997, Queen Elizabeth said, and I quote, "History cannot be rewritten, however much we might sometimes wish otherwise. It has its moments of sadness as well as gladness. We must learn from the sadness and build on the gladness." Sadness and gladness apart, what India has been demanding for 72 years now is a simple apology. Shouldn't be too hard. In April this year, the UK Parliament held a debate on the massacre in the Westminster Hall. The then Prime Minister Theresa May referred to the massacre as a shameful scar, but fell short of an apology yet again. Before May, David Cameron, former Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, was the most forthcoming on the issue. In 2013, he called the massacre as a quote-unquote deeply shameful event. Ordering fire on thousands of civilians who assembled for peaceful protests is rather shameful. One that deserves a full-blown apology. But UK has so far been hiding behind Winston Churchill's statement. It has also been playing down the number of people who were killed. Churchill, who was Secretary of State for War at the time of Jallianwala Bagh massacre, called it a monstrous event. Instead of apologising for the crime, the UK has been seeking to improve its trade ties with India. It wants India's friendship. As and when Brexit happens, it will need India to keep its economy intact. Ties with the United Kingdom will always remain rocky until Britain gives a full-blown apology. In fact, it's about time they face the realities of their imperialistic past. Over to the Korean Peninsula, North Korean media has now released pictures of leader Kim Jong-un overseeing the testing of a super-large multiple rocket launcher. It is the eighth launch since the meeting between US President Donald Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un at the demilitarized zone took place. Kim Jong-un, who had guided the testing of the same multiple rocket launcher before, said its capabilities have been finally verified in terms of combat operation. According to the South Korean military, the projectiles were fired from the South Pyongyang province. The two new unidentified projectiles flew for over 330 kilometers to the east. The timing of this launch is strange in several ways and puts it apart from the previous ones. All of North Korea's launches last month were a mark of protest against the military exercise between the US and South Korea. But this time, the launch came hours after North Korea expressed willingness to restart talks with the US. Reports indicate that these tests, in fact, show North Korea's growing military prowess. Many of the new missiles are capable of evading interception by the US, South Korea, and Japan. Trump said that he had, in fact, taken note of the launches, but did not comment any further. Remember, in the past, Trump has extended a long rope to North Korea whenever such launches have been carried out.